Kenneth William David Hensley.
Oh, God.
Born the 24th of August, 1945.
Yes, sir.
Good. Well, you're heading towards a big anniversary next year, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
And you still seem to be going on like, you know, as strong as Johnny Walker, the good old whiskey.
No, I'm like the Energizer Bunny.
Well, what makes you go on like this? Where do you get the inspiration from?
It's a great question. Music has been my life for a very long time. And in fact, it's been my life all my life. And there is no greater pleasure for me in life than being able to share it with other people. And so for me, my favorite time of the day is to be on stage with an audience and just playing and sharing the music. Next February, I'll make a new album. So as long as the inspiration is there, so long as the people want me to play, then I will continue to play, as long as I physically can.
Ken Hensley of the 1970s and Ken Hensley of today, what's the difference? Is there any difference?
Yeah, the difference is the Ken Hensley of the 1970s was wild, crazy, young, rich, and stupid. And I lived the rock and roll life completely. And I enjoyed it thoroughly. All my dreams came true, all the dreams I had when I was a little boy. I just get the same amount of pleasure from music, but I don't have quite as much pressure. In those days, there was a lot of pressure to always come up with new songs, always come up with new albums, always fulfill these industry-led obligations. And now I don't have that. I have a lot more freedom, and that's, I think, what I enjoy the most, is being able to just express myself the way I truly want to. So there's many, many differences. Of course, I have responsibilities now. I had none of those when I was 25. But fortunately, everything fits into place. It's good. It's good.
Well, how about the audience? Has the audience changed? Because tonight at the gig, I think you'll see three generations. Your fans of the 1970s, who are grandparents now, obviously. You'll see their children, who are parents. And you might see the teenagers. So you'll have three generations at your gig.
Well, that would be great. I'd love that. I mean, it's a perfect world in that sense, because the one thing I've noticed in Russia, in all the former Soviet countries, and all of Eastern Europe, when they come to my solo shows, the parents bring their children. And the children will tell me that they were educated by their parents when they were very young, and they heard all these songs and all these albums, and they were indoctrinated. This is rock and roll. This is real music. And most of them believe it. And so for me, it's such a pleasure when I look out into the audience and I see, as you say, the demographic, which is just a little less than my age, and still enjoying the music and so on. And they've introduced their offspring to it. And so who knows how long I'll be around, but the music will be around forever. So it's really wonderful.
Whatever, there's the rock and roll, there's always this cliche floating around. How true is it, I wonder? What I mean is sex, drugs, and rock and roll.
Yeah.
How true is that one?
Absolutely, completely true. Absolutely. You know, in my solo concerts, I invite the audience to ask me questions. And as long as there's no underage children in the audience, we can talk about anything they want to talk about.
And do you get that question?
Oh, yeah, I offer it.
How are you?
I offer it. Okay. I tell them they can ask me about sex, drugs, yeah, and rock and roll. They can ask me about football or Formula One or my other passions. And occasionally somebody even asks me about music. But so, okay, that's a little radical.
I'm not going to ask you about sex and drugs then, and okay, the rock and roll tonight.
Okay. It was there. I mean, it was part of the 70s lifestyle, and it changed drastically in the 80s. And yeah. But it was fun, and nobody hurt anyone. We just had a good time. And so it was part of the scene, and, you know, I remember it well.
Good. Now, tell me, please, have you written your swan song already?
No, sir, absolutely not. It's really interesting you ask that question, because I wrote a song. I retired for a long time because I had a bad drug habit, and I needed time to get rid of it. I needed time to be me again. And so once I had managed to do that, then I had to make the decision, do I want to take the same risks now that I took when I was 18? You know, do I want to get back into the business and into a business that doesn't really care about me too much? I discovered that I needed to relearn writing songs. It's really funny. I could write poetry and I could write prose, and I started to write songs. This is going back about 15 years. But it wasn't until I wrote a song called The Last Dance that I really felt like I had learned again how to write meaningful songs, which made me feel good. And the first question I got from somebody that heard this song was, well, is this the last dance? And I said, well, yeah, it may be.
It's obvious. Yeah.
It might be. It could be. But it doesn't say how long the dance will be. So yeah. I'm not going anywhere anytime soon. As long as the Lord gives me health and strength.
That's very good news for all your plans. You're in no hurry to go anywhere. Right.
I'm in no hurry. It's up to God. Whatever God wants me to do, I'll do.
Good. Now, which of your songs that you've written is most precious to you?
That's an almost impossible question to answer because there are 340-odd songs in my catalogue. I select tonight's show from 52 songs which changed my life. And those include songs like July Morning, songs like Rain, Lady in Black, so many songs. The problem is that the songs, it's not really what song is most precious to me. It's the fact that the songs are most precious to the people that bought them, listened to them, and are still attached to them in some way or other. And I made a deeper connection with the audience in this country than I did anywhere else, just because of the prohibition, the fact that it was forbidden. Somehow there was a much deeper connection and affection for the music. And when I look off the stage and I play a song and I see people crying, laughing, hugging, all of this, I mean, this is not something I imagined when I wrote the song at all. I mean, I just wrote the song for an album. But now, 44 years later, I see that this music means so much to so many people. To put it into one song, I couldn't do it. It's not possible. It's whatever song the people love, and they all come from my heart. So it's that simple.
Well, Romance happens to be one of my favorites. I hope you're going to do it tonight, then.
If you ask me, I'll do it.
Okay.
I have it in my book.
Good. Okay. Now, I understand that Romance has some kind of Russian connection.
Oh, yeah.
It's
based on a musical called Juno and Avos.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And my record company in Moscow at the time wanted to produce an English language version of this. And so they said, we don't like the lyrics that the translator has done. Would you please rewrite the lyrics? So they sent me the music and they sent me the lyrics and I completely rewrote the whole thing. So, yes, those are the roots and, you know, structurally, musically, it's very typically Russian. And when I played a show recently in Chernigov in Ukraine, I had an orchestra and a string quartet and two ballet dancers that interpreted that song. And it was spectacular. It was beautiful. So if you ask me nicely, I'll play it for you tonight.
Thank you very much. Well, and of course, you've traveled far and wide across Russia. So have you got a feeling what the country and the people are like? Through your audiences, maybe?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not an architecture kind of guy. I'm mainly a people and animal person. So I get more of a sense of what makes a place tick from the people I meet and the people I talk to. But the problem is, as always, is it's perennial, perpetual. I'm in town for such a short space of time. Yeah. I really don't get time to absorb stuff. And, you know, guidebooks don't do a whole lot for me because the translations are usually horrible. And I usually end up correcting the translations. But, I share this with my friends back home. I was in Kazan recently, and I was so fascinated by the whole history of the Tatarstan area, republic, that I wrote a letter to the London Times about it because, you know, here you have a great juxtaposition of Muslim and Christian faith living together in peace, which shows that it can be done. So all this stuff that's going on in the Middle East is kind of out of context, really.
And this is your second time in Belgorod, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I think 5 years.
Oh, wow.
Something like, I don't know. Yeah. I mean, I can't have a cast iron memory of these things because I go so many places in between times.
Oh, that's very good. It's very good. As I recall, Uriah Heep is the name of a character from a Charles Dickens novel.
From David Copperfield.
Yeah, David Copperfield.
I confess I have not read the book.
Oh, you haven't?
No.
Oh, okay.
Before you ask, I have not read the book.
But maybe, okay, it might be a bit of a tricky question, but anyway, I'm just curious.
Right.
It's just out of curiosity. This guy, Uriah Heep, in the novel, he was a bit of a schemer. And he was trying to take over the company where he was employed. So, Uriah Heep, why Uriah Heep as a name for a rock band? Were you planning at the time maybe to take over the rock and roll scene?
No. You make a very good point, and it's really relevant. But the band, when I joined it, was called Spice. Mm-hmm. And it was Mick Box, Paul Newton, Ian Napier, Alex Napier, and David Byron. And I was kind of brought into the band to add keyboards. Well, the music evolved so much into such a completely different direction that the manager decided we needed a new name. Now, 69-70 was the time in England when we were celebrating, as we perversely do, the 100th anniversary of Charles Dickens' death. And so his plays were all over television, all over theatre. And one night, apparently Jerry, our manager, saw David Copperfield on television, and the name Uriah Heep struck him. And he came to the rehearsal room and said, I think we should change the name to Uriah Heep. And we said, fine, 1, 2, 3, 4. We didn't care what it was called at all. We just wanted to play. It did cause a lot of problems. But the irony was, at the end of the day, our manager absconded with a lot of our money. So the irony is really that it was him that suggested the name Uriah Heep.
See, he was a Uriah Heep.
Uriah Heep was a pretty bad guy, so I leave it there.
Yeah, okay. You made a huge contribution to rock and roll and to making Uriah Heep a big-time band in its own time. And, well, I forgot my question.
It's all right.
I forgot
happens.
My question.
Hey, sometimes I get up and I get up in the morning. I go out to the garage,
That's
and when
right.
I get there, I forget what I want there for. So don't feel bad.
Okay, I just remembered it now. Right, I remember reading in one of the publications that Uriah Heep was the most legendary progressive rock band in the United Kingdom. Now, I'm curious about the word progressive here. I mean, how was it? How much was it progressive compared to the other big-time bands of that time?
Well, first of all, I the word progressive didn't enter into the rock and roll dictionary until towards the end of the 70s. It was some people that were trying to emulate what we were doing, but they were way too good musicians. And so they couldn't write songs, but they could make this incredibly technical music, and they wanted it to be called rock and roll, so they called it progressive rock and roll.
I see.
Now, is what I understand progressive to mean. I guess you could take some songs that we did, like Salisbury, for example, and you could call them progressive. I'm not a fan of labels at all. I think the people that create labels are these people. They're the ones who, you know, like what they like, and they put it where they want to put it. That's fine with me. So I would say, number one, that we were not deliberately or consciously a progressive rock band or prog band. Number two, if we wanted to talk who's the best, it depends on who you talk to. Because, you know, you have the Deep Purple fans, you have your Uriah Heep fans, you have your Led Zeppelin fans, you have your Black Sabbath fans. And there's very little crossover there. And I remember in the 70s that could only be either a Deep Purple fan or a Uriah Heep fan. So if you talk to a Deep Purple fan, they'll tell you that the Purple was the best prog rock band in the UK. And if you talk to a Heep fan, they'll tell you the opposite. So for me personally, it was enough just to see all my dreams come true, to make records, to sell millions of records, to travel all over the world. And we used to play festivals together. You know, Heap, Zeppelin, Sabbath, Purple, Moody Blues, all these bands. We used to just play these great big festivals in parks in the middle of cities like Hamburg. And it was just the most incredible event. There was no security, there was no dressing rooms, there was no nothing.
So you weren't so much rivals, but pals more likely.
Well, I mean, there was rivalry there, of course, because we were competing in many cases for the same dollar, if you like. But we always wanted to be better than the others. But there was a camaraderie there created from the fact that we knew we were doing something new and revolutionary. So there was a camaraderie there that superseded any negative rivalry at all.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Well, do you see all these instruments here?
Yes, I do.
Would you like to do a little warm-up session, maybe?
I'll croak a few words for you. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Okay, no problem.
Спасибо.